craft would be a love bug, but Valentine's Day being, bumblebee, I believe, the kids are gonna be on the cookies, the presents, enough sugar, you can put that all week, I'm sure. But that's tomorrow from 12 to 4. Like I said, tonight, we have the first in our lecture series, titled, Pomeroy's First War, and I believe we'll be dealing with a lot of the 19th century. Shannon will be speaking, about his, vast knowledge of the subject. I've come to know him in the past several months, but I've been on the board, he's been on the board much longer than I have. He's actually vice president of the board, very dedicated to the society, but I'm the kind of person who loves history, loves Meigs County history. Shannon does as well. But whereas I hope to gain knowledge and learn a lot of subject, I look to Shannon as a person who has already had that knowledge, and I'm very excited to hear what he has to say tonight about this specific topic. I know it'll also be reading some poems and works by James Edwin Campbell and James McHenry Jones, two fellows with fantastic first names. And maybe a song and dance, I don't know. Without further ado, I would ask you to join me in giving a warm welcome to Mr. Shannon Scott.
His father asked if he could address the school board.
director, speaking to principal, and principal told him to get his books, that he could be in class with the other students, and they continued to. He graduated, valedictorian. Pomeroy Academy gave a speech when he come to class, capturing the entire town with white and black. He was also district grandmaster of the Ohio State of Ohio. At the time, it was the strongest, most rich, richest, most powerful fraternal organization in the country among our people. To be a leader among them meant to be a leader among our race. So this brother John Jones said that about him. This man, James McHenry Jones, wrote three books. Hearts of Gold, it was a widely disputed, sought after by all. During the time of controversy over sending the Negro back to Africa. His second book was called Strange Transformation, and it was in the publisher's hands when he died in the ministry of his period. His third book is called Blue Veins. He was ready for publishing at the time of his death. Mr. McHenry Jones was the third president of West Virginia State University, which is now West Virginia State University, with West Virginia College Institute and Normal School. Normal School was, like the equivalent high school. The Institute was a trade school. They taught people life skills. Now I will read you his speech. James McHenry Jones seconding Mr. Atkinson's nomination in the State Republican Convention at Parkersburg, West Virginia. It created great enthusiasm and published by general request. Professor Jones said, "On the field of Gettysburg, it is said the soldiers wearing the blue and the gray were buried after the battle in long trenches, one to one another. A traveler who passed over the immortal battleground a few days afterward declared that the earth over which these soldiers so gloriously died and under which they were so ignominiously covered swayed up and down. This may be fact or fiction, but he who observed the signs of the times must be cognizant of the tremors from the irresistible groundswell which began in St. Louis and will not cease until the rolls incomplete, democracy out of the White House. I misinterpret the spirit and the intelligence of the American people. If there, by their permission, that herd of wild-eyed fanatics which broke loose at Chicago ever heads towards the national capital, the Republican Party is confronted today, as it has been in the past, with wild speculation and untenable theories. But true to its tradition, it fearlessly faces blatant slogan of error with the gleaming torch of drink industry. The history of our party is simply a record of triumphs of right. We were right in 1856 at the birth of Republicanism, right in 1860 under the leadership of the immortal Lincoln, right in 61 when it was determined that one black wavered the undivided country and liberty should not perish from the face of the earth. Doubly right in 63. When it was finally concluded that the life of a nation demanded the freedom of the slave. Right under the peerless leadership of Nationalist Soldier Grant. Right in the resumption of the specie payment under Hayes. Right under Garfield. Right under Harrison. Eternally right when under James G. Blaine and William McKinley were welded in a common chain of protection and reciprocity. We are right today, when against the atonement and above the roar and the battle of populism, but we assert our intention to defend to the last ditch the national honor and preserve inviolate and untarnished institutions transmitted to us from our forefathers. And the grand old party will be right in November. When it rings from the red mouth popular democracy, the black hissing tongue of anarchy. West Virginia is naturally Republican, and the candidate name born within her borders will not be necessary to look into the misty record of the forgotten past to extract his name from the cobwebs of the oblivion. He is known from where the rugged Alleghenies lift their giant shoulders up into the trackless blue, to where the fretful canal unites the muddy Ohio and on her restless mission to the sea. To the eastern panhandle of the southern extremity of the state, the name, the fame of George W. Magnuson is by word in the mouth of an admiring people. The logical candidate, his is a fitting name which to close the century. The 19th century grows apace, already the fading glow approaching twilight throws its lengthening shadows around us. Soon the rosy morn of the new century, fresh fallen from the fingertips of God, with dawn upon the ruddy face, dawn upon his ruddy face, with golden perspiration, will sense his fierce gleam offered the oceans of time. Steadily, majestically, forth, the flagship McHenry, the Behringer, the Harbinger, the advanced agent of a better way. Confidence after 4 years wandering in the dismal swamp of democratic illusion, return in the rainbow hues of heaven and bright the one in blazing, imperishable records of the Republic. Prosperity, protection, and patriotism. The good ship West Virginia, cut loose from its democratic moorings, must be directed by a helmsman trained to the sea. A pilot with a cool head, discerning eye, pure life, strong arm, and open hand in patriotic heart. Ohio County believes that these qualifications are transcendent and developed in the superb statesman, the Ruth Scholar, far-seeing party leader, and Christian general, the Honorable George Wesley Adams. Therefore, in the name of Republicans of Ohio County, whose idol he is, in the name of the unconditional Republicans of West Virginia, who love him as their friend, I hereby second the nomination to the next governor of West Virginia. And after this, he formed the party. James Atkinson Party. They followed. He spoke many times. He spoke in front of many crowds. His last speech was in Washington State. He represented an Episcopal church of West Virginia. And he spoke in Seattle in front of 8,000. And he came. He was the first African American to graduate from a white school. And it happened. He was 10 years before the RN passed. The next county. And that's something we all should be proud of. Yes, this is African American history, but it's our history. We've all got family from here, many generations of family. So I'm sure we all can share that. We all share this history with y'all. It's our history, it's not just our history. Now, Mr. Jones, he was, like I said, he was the third president of West Virginia State University, founder of the Normal School. He resided in East Hall. After him, five other presidents held this as a residence, and Jones Hall was built in his memory.
James Edwin Campbell. He was the first president of Western State University. He was, technically, he was the principal. They call it the principal. He was there in their infant stages. He helped develop. He helped develop the school into what it became. He doubled their enrollment. And all this started, he was handed this school at the age of 24. Mr. Campbell died at the age of 28. Here in the hospital. He came home, he read his poems and things, his family and friends. It was after Christmas holiday he died at his mother's house. He wrote for the Chicago Tribune. He wrote for Western Enterprise, which is a newspaper. He was principal at Rio, not Rocks. he was principal of Rock Springs. They called it Stepping Stone School. He was principal of Ruff. He was offered to be the principal of the White School, and he refused because he wanted to help his people. Now, the first poem I'm going to read by Mr. Campbell is what is referred to as his best work. This is the quiet, and it's rather long. And my best thing to get through this. Owned or bought all the factories, which the blackened smoke sent up, miles and miles all around the country, from the towns by hills pent up. Traced he back his proud ancestry to the rock on Plymouth shore. Traced I mine to the Dutch ship, landing at Jamestown the year before. Thus was she of hawky lineage, I of mongrel race had sprung, o'er my father's in warfield, woods and scorpions have been swung. Years of freedom was her race's, years of forced labor mine. Years of culture were her race's, years of dark labor mine. She a lily sought by all men, I a thistle shunned by all. She a Brahmin, I a bride. Who must ever be? Who must ever be all? Fair was I as her complexion. Honest came my fairness too. For my father and my mother were in wedlock bands. Yes, this mixing of the races had been years, long years ago, that you could not trace the stream to the fountain which winds the blood. Like an eagle long imprisoned, soared I to the realms of light, scorning all the narrow valley where my wings had cleaned the flight. In the sun of modern science, I had soaring bathed my wings, and rose higher and higher and higher above the world of narrow things. Then on proudly soaring pinions, I forgot my lonely bird. When the cast arrow venom laden struck me, shot me down the earth. Kind and friendly had she ever seemed and acted unto me, till of late a cold green statement seemed to bar her manner's degree. Then my sensitive soul's quick thinking that the pride of caste was born in her mind grew cold and vision, thoughts pricking like a thorn. And my thoughts grew dark and bitter, bitter as wild aloe. I became a sneering cynic, deeming every man a foe, scorning books while scorning people. In their pages not I saw, but I lied, but I censored every sentence, every flaw. Till one night the mad mob gathered, called in voices wild and loud. I should quickly come before them and address the raging crowd. There were strikers who were working for her father, stern and proud. They threatened to destroy him and his works and curses loud. At the call I stepped before them, they greeted wild and strong. My heart grew hot with hatred of oppression, caste, and wrong. While the words poured out like lava from the crater of my brain, burning, seething, hissing, raging, with the years of pent-up pain. They had gathered by the great works with their blazing furnace doors and the lofty flaming chimneys up the throats of the hot glass doors. And the furnace threw its hot light on their toil-worn, swarthy faces, while the flames from out the chimneys painted heavens with their blazes. In their hands they held their weapons, tools for work, tools for toil, not for war. When the great mill rolled in thunder, shaking heaven with its jar. And their brows were dark with hatred, and their cheeks were hot with rage, and their voices were low and growling like wild beasts in a cage. And the tiger rose within him with a growl that was a curse, and I breathed his breath of passion, and I felt his awful thirst. But her image came before me with her sad, reproachful eyes, and her loss of sunset splendor when the summer sunlight dies. Then vanished was hot passion, while mercy pleaded low, and I cooled their angry fury as a hot iron in the snow. And she comes and stands before me as I blaze into the stream, and I see her, I behold her, as in vision and dream. And the waves of love come surging, and they sweep my will away, for I love her, oh I love her, and forever. And I call her Eve, Eve, as I call her off before, when as guideless children we picked lilies from the shore. Oh, my voice sobbed like a harp string when the rough hand breaks the cord, and it wailed in mine sadly as some broken hearted bard. And she came up to me quickly when I thus wailed out her name. All her soul rose in her blue eyes. There was a mere look of shame. And she threw her arms up to me, and I caught her in my heart, while the whole world reeled beneath me, and the heavens fell apart. Faint and trembling, then I asked her what the cruel world would say, while she blushed, but spoke out bravely, "We'll forget the world today." This I only know, I love you. I have loved you all the while. What care I then for your lineage, or harsh words, frown, or smile? Men are noble from their actions, from their deeds and theirs alone. Fathers' deeds are not their children's, reap not what that others have sown. They are not like dwarfish pygmies who would scorn you for your birth, who would scorn you for your lineage, raise not their eyes from the earth. What is blood? The human body. Trace it back, the leaf, the dust. Trace it forward, same conclusion. Not the vile dust finds you most. But the soul is sent from heaven, and the sculptor's hand is God. Part and parcel of his being, while our bodies are the clods. It's written in 1889. He was a dialect poet and writer. And I'm here to tell you hard. So I'm going to do my best. Praise, the tears come stealing down my cheek, the voice of God widening me speak. I see myself so full and weak, down on my knees, the cross I see. When old sis duty prayed, the thunders of Mount Sinai comes rushing down from up on high, the devil turns back and flies. While sinners loud the pardon's cry, when old sis Judy prays. When old sis Judy prays, had sinners trembling in their seats, they hear in her voice in sorrow of peace. While all the When old Sis Judy prayed, the whole house hits the rock and moaned. To see her tears and hear her groan, there's something in Sis Judy's tones that melts the heart made of stone. When old Sis Judy prayed. When old Sis Judy prayed, salvation's light comes pouring down. It fills the church and all the town, while angels rose go rustling round, and heaven on earth is found. When old Sis Judy prays, the souls go weeping up on wings, and loud the church wide glory rings, and wide the gates of jasper swings. Will you hear harps with golden strings? When old Sis Judy prays. When old Sis Judy dies, from tribulations justified, I know the gates will just fly wide, and the King Jesus by her side. Straight through them golden paved streets she'll ride, when old Sis Judy dies.
Great. There are no more than the title claims, the simple
to the public is customary, that I must dedicate to someone.
But who?
Who will consider it an honor to be so remembered? No one. Yes, there is one. To this one, then I dedicate it. To the one whose every heartbeat has been as loyal and as true to me as a pointing needle to the pole, who has with loving care and anxious solicitude watched over me my every step from infancy to boyhood and from boyhood to the threshold of manhood. I have tottered, then walked over the flint slopes and stubble shores of this life. To the one who thought no sacrifice too great, no denial too severe for the pleasure, comfort, and advantage of her boy. To the one whose every thought has been for my welfare, and whose patience I have oftentimes sorely tired with my boyish and strong wish, and whose kind acts I have perhaps too often accepted as written in law. To that dear, holiest, safest, best blessing ever shared to a boy, I dedicate this book to my mother. Love droops, friends may fail, and the leaves of friendship fall, but the tender love of a mother outlives them all.
Waves.
the lamb she sells, poor lamb who sells his life. Her fair white hand, young over his mind, her soul dropped over her soul of mine. Ride on, man, ride on. No title high for my father bore, the tenant of thy farm. He left me, but I value more, a clean heart, clear brain, strong arm. And love for bird and beast and bee and song of lark and hymn of sea. Right on, my young Lord, right on. The boundless sky to me belongs, the paltry acres nine. The painted beauty sings thy songs, the live rock looks be mine. The hothouse orchids bloom for thee, the gorse of heather bloom for me. He was just kind of talking about how things went for her and how things went for him, and then unfortunately they kind of happened like that back in the days. This is Uncle S. Banjo's. Clean the van. He's the son of James and Lisa Campbell. He graduated from Pomeroy High School, class of 1884. After graduation, he taught various parts of Meigs County, achieved notoriety as an African-American poet, editor, authored short stories, and educator. He began writing in 1887 with the and during the 1880s and 90s, he wrote regularly for the daily newspapers of Chicago. Widespread popularity, he published a collection of his best works at this room cabin in the office. Campbell was installed as the first president of West Virginia Fellow Institute, West Virginia State University, serving in the capacity from 1891 to 1894. Campbell died January 26, 1896. And is buried at East Grove Cemetery. Go up there sometimes. There were other children from this school that went on to do great things. Well, you know, great for the times. The schoolhouse is not a little red brick, but a one-room frame structure with only one very good key man teacher. Our bunch started the school on the Monday morning following our arrival. We found here were some of the very clever people, well advanced for their age, and discovered that we would have to study hard to keep up with them. I have not at that time, nor have I ever, and at any time since, found children more eager for education. No town in the state of Ohio has produced and sent out into the world as many outstanding men and women as it came out of this class. J. Joe Spears, product of the Little Frame Building, one of the leading orators in the state of Ohio, Knoll and Knoll Valley. James McHenry Jones, preacher, author, orator, at the time of his death, president of West Virginia State Collegiate and Normal School. James E. Campbell, teacher, poet, orator, and one time president of West Virginia Collegiate and Normal School. Fleming Lee Jones, willing school teacher, banker, first Negro in the United States of America, secure charter for national bank. Mr. Jones, brother. Calvin Morton, merchant. John L. Jones, merchant and writer of this book. Ollie Wilson, teacher, orator. John R. Jefferson, teacher, principal, Parkersburg School for 25 years, orator, no means, but recognized ability. Edward Morton, teacher, scholar. Miss Bertha Morton and her sister, teachers. Irene Chilton Moses, teacher, principal, and writing of this book, only the advisory board of the state of West Virginia. C.E. Jones, scholar, teacher, taught at West Virginia Collegiate Institute for 32 years. Gary Hazelwood, scholar, teacher, and the writing is the principal of the school in Huntington, West Virginia. Time will fail me to cite more of the boys and girls who came from under the rocks and the hills of the First World War. And I don't want to bore anybody. Alright. This is Mr. Campbell wrote a letter. He wrote a letter to Thomas Hutchman of North Cumberland, England. And this is about what Mr. Campbell felt passionately about the dialect poetry. He talked about, he referred to it as the old Negro aunt and uncle. They were dying, and we do not remember how they spoke. This is the dialect poetry, or the dialect poetry is just an example of how they really spoke. It's hard to sound without. All right, here it goes. My dear sir, your letter came to me safely a week ago and put flight to a vicious attack of hypochondria. As a very pleasant coincidence to your letter, Mr. Rodell's, there's a mobile. Mr. Rodell's, whose father lives here, came up from Galveston and spent 2 or 3 days, and we spent the afternoon together. I have known him from my childhood, and his friendship has been quite helpful to me. From him I learned that you have published several volumes of your poems, knowing that I almost feared to send you the several clippings which you will find enclosed. For the last 3 months, I have been devoting my time to writing verse that embodies the characteristic humor and pathos of the Negro. I feel that the education of the race and the death are fast destroying these two elements of psychic composition of my race. I mean that the younger part of the race are being educated away from the quaint dialect, and that indescribable something which more than the color of skin distinguishes the Negro from all other Americans. Death is rapidly destroying the old Negro aunt and uncle, and in a few years they will live only in the characteristics. Is it possible to obtain a volume of your poems? Has much Negro dialect been published in the English periodicals? Do you think a tale of Negro life embodying these two characteristics of the Negro humor in Negro dialect, or humor and pathos, would find the acceptance in your English periodicals. I had hoped to send you with this a poem, not in Negro dialect, which has recently been accepted, but has not yet appeared. I sometimes become very discouraged. Your letter found me so. Some friends are urging me to collect my stories and verses of the last 2 or 3 years into a neat body, but while I know my work is better than when I was sent out in my little book in 1887, yet I am not now so ignorant of reading world and terrible critics. I cannot tell why it is writing to you. I put so much of myself in, so much of my future hopes, so much of my of the dear, sad longing that fills my soul at times until it throbs with pain. Shall I hope for an early answer? Faithfully yours, James Edwin Campbell.
So Shannon, the selections that you chose are end of the Civil War, generally, end of the Civil War to the beginning of the 20th century. And I'm kind of curious if you have any idea of what the percentages of population were of African Americans in Pomeroy and in Meigs County.
I don't have census records to give you those numbers. Now, nationwide, in, I would say, 1870, of the 28 million people that, 6.5 million African Americans. And illiterate. Between the end of the Civil War and 1900, there were 30,000 African American teachers taught, sent out to teach those people. And we had quite a few come out from our school. As I said, 10 years before, there was a lot of mixing and racism in school. They had to leave. Yes. There were schools in Brooklyn. At the end of the Civil War, there were 3,000 black people. No, I don't. I'm sure that a lot of these structures are still around. They were small. They don't look like the schools are there now. But I'm sure they couldn't.
You never called me that before. I will put a plug in for Shannon Scott. You started this this is the project that's at least 3 years in making. This 1 hour talk tonight, he spent at least 3 years working on it. Give us an idea of how many hours and how much time you've actually put into this. It's an amazing amount of work.
I probably couldn't tell you how many hours of it. I don't have to look at much of the stuff. To read his poetry, I have to look at it, but to tell you about him and his accomplishments, I don't have to read any of his stuff because I spent a lot of time studying on it. And my daughter Tyra, brought James Edwin Campbell into my line of sight. I'm 44, I never knew who this man was.
I would go out on a limb and say that if you went to around the United States to talk about Campbell, you're probably one of 5 or 16 experts on the man right now, I would say. And I've done a little research on it. I mean, my heart's hard to believe.
Well, I'm kind of passionate about what he did. I just haven't been recognized for the accomplishments, the things that they made their way through. Just to be smart people, just to educate their fellow men. He he was a mathematician. And that breaks the traditional link that mathematicians aren't supposed to be right.
So this guy who broke the mold is a mathematician.
His parents were Mary Shannon Campbell. Mr. Campbell's, his father's name was James. His mother's name was Mary Shannon. Mary Shannon Campbell.
What did they do?
I think his father was his mother, she was probably home. They said that Mr. Campbell was a very quiet person, didn't share much about before teaching. He kept that kind of shelter from people. Why, I don't know. But I can understand. I guess you've done some part of your life to be proud of.
The daughter's first day of school being able to be put on the library computers now that all the white schools are listed, but not the back school. The daughter's school is still standing down there, next to the old language.
I think it would be, I would love to have that place one from the national election. I would love to be a thing on how to say that.
What year did you say he was born?
Mr. Campbell, 1867. And Mr. Dillon was born in 1859. And I'm sorry I don't have the images to show you. I really didn't say what the most important thing. I like you. yourself, you run into roadblocks everywhere. So to find this, which is kind of like Roots, the story Roots, to find this, so I guess this is because this man thought it important enough to write 107 years of his family history so future generations would know who they were and who they came from. You can buy the copies. Yeah, you can buy the copies. This just happens to be an original. But they do sell them. And Mr. Jones' book, Mr. McHenry Jones, he has Hearts of Gold, West Virginia University has republished that book in 2010. And it's on life during the post-Civil War and different things. They need to, you know, kind of spell out these places and just the atrocity of the power. I mean, there's some, but the neighborhood that I'm talking about is gone. The only thing is standing the church and the school. A neighborhood that used to be huge. It was huge. From what I remember as a kid, there were probably 20 more houses just on that corner there where the intersection is. You know, the house and the building. So we told me about the playhouse that they had down there. They called it the playhouse or something. It was a warehouse, and the teenage kids used to go down there and just hang out and have a little time. And on down in there, there was a park with a big baseball diamond and a large swing, and all that stuff was gone. It was all woods.
I don't like that one.
If you go all the way down to the last life, you make a left, you go up that hill, that whole neighborhood, right there, that's it. You're driving.
Wow. That was a little African American
neighborhood. Between here and Meigs now.
Yeah. All right. We drift through it.
Pretty much. Mm-hmm. When you drive up a red light, well, I'm going to forget where it starts. Maybe it might start near your house and it goes all the way up around the corner. And down behind the beacons where the park and all that stuff was, and there's houses that went around there, houses that lined both sides. A house here and a house here. I mean, there was like roads or steps. Shane house, Shane roads. Houses on stilts. Yeah, and I can understand why they needed the intersection change. My own particular state buckles up there. And I'm sure there have been other people did there. But in doing so, the whole thing was gone. And the only part left was the church and school. And the church has been halfway customized into a house. And I'm very disappointed. I would like to get it and just fix it all back the way it was. Even like this Saturday. That's how I feel about it.